My name is Rohna, and I'm going to give all my names. Rohna, Sharfman, Isaacson, Shoul. I decided I'd put in my mother's name as well as my father's name and my married name. And the date is January 30th, 2002. Okay, and I also want to say at this moment, for historical purposes, that Rohna is spelled R-O-H-N-A. But I will not go into the reason for it, except that there's only one other person in the whole world who has the same spelling. Okay.
That's very important.
Very important, right. And I thought I'd start really from the beginning, because the beginning, really, where I came out of, essentially, was when my grandfather emigrated from Russia about 1898 with his four daughters, the youngest one of which was my mother, who was probably about 7 or 8. Her mother, my grandmother, had died in Russia several years before that, and she was the last child. There was one brother who was older and stayed there and emigrated later on. But as one of my sons pointed out, he was a single father. And as a single father, he took these four girls. The oldest probably was about maybe 13 or 15, nobody really knows. And they came here, and they came to Boston. And they came to Boston because he had a brother here, and this is totally the immigrant experience. One brother is more adventuresome and leaves, and then the next one comes. That brother left probably in the 1880s, settled in Boston, and then my grandfather came after his wife died. And they all piled in together in one apartment. The other brother had four children, and my grandfather and his four children. And my mother and aunt told of having to share a bed with one other cousin, so there were three of them in one bed. And that's how they got started. And they started in the West End of Boston, which to me is very historically significant. They landed at Castle Island, which was a port of immigration at that point. Is no longer. I don't know when it stopped. And the West End of Boston was a vital, teeming community of immigrant Jews, Italians, Poles, which no longer exists. And that's why I feel it's so important. It was destroyed during urban renewal in the 60s. But from the period until urban renewal, this was a vital community. And then the decision was made in the 50s that you had to tear everything down. Instead of looking, it would never happen now. For those who don't know, there was North End of Boston, the South End of Boston, East Boston, and the West End. And the West End comprised that area around where the Mass General Hospital is now, essentially, and going toward North Station, but it is gone. And what exists now is Charles River Park, parts of the Mass General, and shopping center. When I became really aware of what was going on, and the building started to come down, I decided to take my two children, my two oldest sons, and let them see where the family roots were. And I'd never gone back. In all the years, I just had never gone back. I passed by all the time, driving to the Southeast Expressway. And we went and we parked, and I took them. And it was like London after the Blitz. And I had been in London just a few years after the war was over with the total devastation. And my son, who was probably about 7 at the time, remembers it very well, because the buildings were down. some buildings were left with the facade off. You could see the rooms inside. And we walked through this area where my mother had grown up, where the whole family had been, and where I had lived off and on as a child. And I deeply resent it, because it is so important if people have, if they can go back to where they came from. It's a terrible feeling to go back and see it in devastation. And now I'm there, it was sometimes once a month actually, walking up in that area, and you think about this building was here and that building was there, and it's gone. So that's a, it's a part of Boston history that has just been obliterated. But growing up in the partly in the West End and partly moving in and out of the West End because it was the Depression, and so we tended to move around a lot. Wherever there was a cheaper place to live, my mother found it, and off we would go. But we did go back to the West End when I was in the fourth and fifth grade. And I remember that very poignantly because it was the first time I stayed put in one school and in one house, or is it an apartment house, for 2 years. Prior to that, we moved every year, sometimes twice a year. And so I was constantly changing schools, not having a chance to really make friends, although I'm sure I did make friends. I was pretty outgoing, but I don't remember any of them. But in those 2 years in the West End, I remember them very fondly. But it was during the Depression, and my father lost his job, and we then moved, I think one year we moved to Brookline, Brighton, and he, in the meantime, had gone to Lewiston, Maine, because that's where his family came from, and there was a business there that he could be absorbed into. And that was what families did. You know, one family member was having a rough time, then somebody else in the family felt an obligation. And my father was an intellectual, but he was an intellectual that never made much money. He read a great deal, he loved to talk, he had ideas, he loved to talk to people about his ideas. It became always a problem because where he worked, he talked to people. He worked in, he had a series of jobs at the Waldorf restaurants in Boston. And he would eventually get fired by the manager because he spent so much time talking. He'd be behind the counter dishing out food and talking to people who he would make friends with. And he happened to know somebody who was the head of personnel. So every time he got fired from one Waldorf restaurant, he would find another Waldorf restaurant. And eventually he ran out of Waldorf restaurants. And at that point, we moved to Lewiston, Maine, where he worked for my uncle, who had an automotive store. And he did the same thing there. And eventually my uncle, by marriage, started complained, so they sent him up to northern Maine, where there were two other uncles. And he repeated, you know, that was just the way he was. He was a very interesting person, extremely interesting. I got a lot of good things from him. But that didn't work. And then eventually, with his mother, my grandmother's help, he started a grocery store in Lewiston. And there he stayed. And that was the perfect place for him, because he could talk to all his customers and run a business. And manage, sort of manage. We managed, not well, but we did manage. And so when I moved to Lewiston, it was like going to the hinterlands for myself and my mother. Lewiston was not a very interesting place to be. There were no lectures, there were no museums. Everything that Boston was so full of that you could enjoy and use without money. You could get a complete education in Boston without having money, just by taking advantage of the cultural institutions, which my mother did. And from the time I was very small, she always took me to the Boston Public Library, to the Children's Museum, to this, wherever there was anything to see. I was an only child. And I was her companion. And that's what we did. And then when you moved from Boston to Lewiston, it was very difficult, very, very difficult. And it was particularly for my mother, because she didn't have her lectures. And in Boston, you have community church. You have Ford Hall Forum, which is still going on. These were centers of actually pretty radical thought, concerns about social reform, labor unions, whatever social ferment was going on at that particular time. I was brought up hearing about the Sacco Vanzetti case from the time I knew anything. I heard about the Sacco Vanzetti case and the injustice of it. But so we came from there to Lewiston, Maine. And I waited anxiously to get out of high school so I could leave Lewiston, Maine. However, I wanted to go to college, and that would have been very difficult. So I stayed in Lewiston, Maine, because Bates College was there. So Bates College was there, and I had an uncle who offered to pay for my tuition. And so I had to stay. And I remember keeping a calendar of 4 years and marking out every day as to how much time was left to get out of Lewiston. And what I did do, though, I accelerated. It was during the war. You know, World War II was in full swing when I entered Bates in 1943. And fortunately for me, at that time, you could accelerate. You could do college in 3 years by going three summers, and you could get out of college in 2.5 years. And so I started in the summer of 1943 and went through the following year and then the next summer. And then when it came to the third summer, I couldn't take it anymore. And so I graduated in 3 years instead of 2.5 years. But in that one summer, I did something that had a profound experience. I joined the Women's Land Army during the war, and I worked on a farm in Maine, in Waterville, Maine, for 2 months, because we had semesters of four months, actually. College was around the clock, four-month semesters. And I worked on this farm, a market garden farm, and I took care of chickens, and I harvested vegetables, and I learned about farming, and I'm sure I became a gardener eventually, and I'm sure my gardening came out of my farming experience, but it was a profound, enlightening experience about what farming was about, the people of this very small rural community, and I really cherish that, having had that opportunity. But when I graduated, I always wanted to be a social worker. Partly why I wanted to be a social worker, primarily, was because during the Depression, when we lived in the West End particularly, and that was in the depths of the Depression, this was probably 1936, we as children, we became aware of the fact that families were going on welfare. Of course, Roosevelt was president at that point, and the social programs had really started in full swing. And I had a friend, and her family was going on welfare, and she was very, very distraught because they had to give up their dog, because the social worker had come and visited and told them that they couldn't have a dog because you have to feed a dog, and you can't include that in a welfare budget. And so if they wanted to, they had to give up their dog. And I thought that was the most dreadful, inhumane thing to do. And I remember, and I was in the fourth grade, and I remember thinking, when I grow up, I'm going to be a social worker, and I'm not going to make anybody give up their dog. So I decided I wanted to become a social worker, and the only way to actually become one was to go to graduate school. I could have stayed in Maine at the time. I was offered a job and the possibility of graduate school if I worked for the public welfare department for several years. And a friend offered me to actually sell me her car cheaply so I could have a car, eventually I could go to graduate school, but the idea of staying in Maine was more than I could take. So I did get into graduate school. I got a scholarship which covered my tuition. And I was able to live with an aunt and uncle. And this was in 1946 from Bates, so I was at BU School of Social Work from 1946 to 1948. And then in the second year of social work school, we have internships. My first internship was the Boston Public Welfare Department, which was a good place. I learned a tremendous amount there. I became the only social worker of the Charlestown Housing Project because they didn't have a social worker. And I was totally exploited, and I never complained because I didn't want to be taken out. So I cherished that experience too. And then the second year, I was placed at the Boston City Hospital, which I really objected to because I felt it was going to be a sort of continuation of my welfare experience. But I met my husband there, so I didn't complain. And I stuck out my second year internship, actually. He was an intern in medicine. I was an intern in social work, and we met on the same service. And we got married, eventually. After I graduated, I went to work at the Mass General Hospital, and he went into his surgical residency. And then we got married in 1949, after I'd been at the Mass General for about 2 years, 3 years, I guess, 40, no, a year and a half. We went through the usual thing, you know, with internships, and we lived at the right across from the Boston City Hospital, where he was continuing, right in the South End, and then we moved to Back Bay, Fenway. We moved to the Fenway, then I got pregnant, then I had a baby, and then in 1950 the Korean War started, when North Korea invaded South Korea. And then from then on, it was a constant worry about when he would have to go, because he was part of the doctor draft. He'd gotten his medical education through the Army, through the, I think what they call the ASTP, mm-hmm. Army Specialized Training Program. So he got his medical education. So naturally, when the Korean War started, all doctors who got their medical education Anyway, he knew he was going to go. And he managed to get his deferred. He kept getting deferment so he could finish his residency, and he did. And he finished his residency in 1951, and in 1952 he went to Korea. And by that time I had a second child, just a year apart from the first child, because we didn't want to take any chances. Remembering that during World War II, a lot of people, you know, they went off to war, and then in 5 years, you know, they wanted to start a family, they were 5 years behind. So we didn't take any chances. It was not easy. I was left with two children, one, and he was in Korea for that 1 year. It was the worst year of my life. And I was fortunate in one way, in other ways too, but my mother came and stayed with me for that 1 year. I don't know how I would have managed otherwise, because these were essentially two very little kids. And we lived on a third floor apartment in Brookline, which meant that I had to go up and down three flights of stairs with a baby carriage or a stroller, and you couldn't leave it. You couldn't leave it downstairs. So I would have to carry the baby, hold on to this two-year-old, and at the same time drag the stroller up the stairs at the same time. And that was my life every day, and except going to the park. The park in Brookline on St. Paul Street saved my life too. That's where I went every day until the snow came. I would just go with the kids and sit there. And see other mothers too, and so that was another savior. Anyway, eventually he came back, and we moved to Newton. We moved to Newton to an apartment with the two children, and at that time, you know, being home with children as a someone who was a professional, which I was probably a rather, it was a lonely experience because you had nobody to talk to. And the one thing that saved me was the League of Women Voters, because I did manage to join the League while I lived in Boston. And, you know, one way or the other, I went out and I met with other women, and we, you know, how the League has study groups, and we were studying juvenile delinquency and the Youth Service Board, and it was stimulating. It was very stimulating. And when I moved to Newton, I joined the League immediately. And that was, you know, good organizational experience. And that another plug for the League. I think the League in general was a haven for so many women who needed the intellectual stimulation that they were not getting staying home with their children, and having an opportunity to become involved in the community, to feel that you had some impact, perhaps by what you were studying and taking actions on. And the League was very sustaining for me. I'm still a member. I'm a member now in good standing of probably 52 years, actually, although I'm not active in it, but I certainly support them, keep track of what they're doing. I even watch them on new TV now.
Typical.
Well, just for clarification for people who might see this at some point, and I'm not sure what the League of Women Voters is. It was an outgrowth of the suffrage movement, and when it was an extraordinary movement that started from the beginning of the, I'm trying to remember now, I can't give dates, but it built up into the suffrage movement, which culminated in 1920 with women achieving the vote, but then left with this large group of women who had worked for the vote. And so there was a women's party, actually, now that I remember. But eventually it became the League of Women Voters of the United States. And so there are leagues all over the country. It's a rather structured organization in that study of issues is very important. And once an issue is studied, a consensus is developed as to if there's going to be action taken. And of course, a lot of it is political. Political action, issues action. In local leagues, they can take action around civic issues. Right now, the League of Women Voters is studying the schools. I believe MCAS school reform. Meetings are held in people's houses. The small study groups. But the important thing is that consensus has to be achieved in order for something to happen. So that makes it a structure, and that has a national structure, a state structure, and a local structure, each one of which will take positions once study is made. That has some significance for the what will come in terms of the peace movement, which is why we're here. Okay. And significantly, too, it is a nonpartisan group. It explores both sides of every issue. It does not take stance politically, and it does not come out in favor of a candidate, although individual League members can certainly support, but not in the name of the League of Women Voters. Once we moved to Newton and we lived in this apartment, and then I became active in the League of Women Voters because my children did start nursery school. And once they were in nursery school, then I had more time. At least I could do things in the morning until they came home. At that point, we then looked for a house because naturally the children were the oldest one was going to go into kindergarten. And then the question came up, where were we going to live? In Newton. And because of the school system, we wanted to stay in Newton, and so we did find a house. And my oldest son at that time was going into kindergarten, and we found a house near the Ward School in Newton. But we couldn't move into it until after kindergarten had started. And so then we began this difficult transition in which he had to be picked up by bus, brought to the ward school every morning until we could move in, which I don't think was until December. And so for those 2 months, this poor kid used to come in late every morning because the bus transportation could not get him there on time. And it did become an issue because he would go into class. He never objected to going to school, but he would go into class and he would scoot over to the teacher's desk, and he would sit there glued to the leg of the desk and not move. And there was nothing that poor teacher could do that could pry him loose from that leg. And some, I think they tried, and he grabbed onto the leg and wouldn't let go. The principal became concerned and felt that a psychiatrist should be consulted. And I thought really it had a lot to do mostly that he was coming in late. And so the teacher felt the same way. And so he lived through it. He was not marked for life. At one point, and that's why I mentioned this, because it was so significant in terms of children. At one point, there was a little boy in class who came up, and all the children knew that Mark would not leave the desk. And he pushed a toy toward him, but not far enough so that Mark could reach it. And Mark wanted it. It was a little truck, and Mark wanted it. And so he reached out for it, and the little boy pulled it back a little. So Mark reached out a little bit more, and he got unstuck. And from that moment on, he joined the class, and that was the end of the problem. So which says something about something. You don't have to rush to a psychiatrist right away. But as soon as he joined, as soon as we moved, and he was, you know, fully ensconced in kindergarten, I joined the PTA. So that was the next phase of my life. Was joining the PTA, and from that moment on, the PTA occupied my life probably for the next 15 years in one form or another. I was president of the PTA, I was very involved in the Creative Arts Committee for the City of Newton, which I was just totally involved through the PTA, through my children. And at this point, we're in the 50s. And to explain again, the PTA was the Parent Teacher Association. It is now called the PTO, which is the Parent Teacher Organization for administrative purposes. I won't go into all of those details. But that was my life, pretty much, for those years that, and I forgot to mention at this point, we had another child in 1957. And so that we had 3 children who went through the Newton schools, and for the whole time that they were in the Newton schools, I was involved in the Parent Teacher Association. And that gave me a background in organizing and knowing and networking and knowing people. And but it took up whatever time I had, I devoted to the PTA. I must say, though, in all those years, and I should say this, I did work. I worked part-time. And in trying to think through this, I realized I had 7 different jobs. Even after when my husband was in the Korean War and my mother was with me, I got a job at the Peter Ben Brigham. I worked in several different hospitals as a social worker, and never had a look for a job, except for my first job at the Mass General, because once you became part of that professional network, you knew people. And if somebody was leaving a job and would call you and say, would you be interested? Or somebody was pregnant and say, would you be interested? And so every job I ever had was part of this professional network. And I'm so impressed with young women today and wonder how they manage working full-time, having several children, doing all the things that the current generation of young women do, which we didn't do. We, at most of us worked, if we worked, we worked part-time. And that is such a more sensible, humane way of functioning and working a life where you can be the kind of person that you're trained to be a mother, and all your other domestic responsibilities. Working full-time is something I never had to do. But as far as, so that even though I was using a lot, so much time for the parent and teacher, I still worked at these various part-time jobs. And when we, as going through the 50s, coming up through the 50s into the early 60s is when the involvement in the peace movement began. And one of the things that really influenced me tremendously, and this relates to our beginnings of our women's peace group, was a book called Brighter Than a Thousand Stars. And that was where I got my first information about the about the atomic bomb and what it really meant. This was a history of the men who had developed the bomb, but it was in the full potential of what nuclear weapons and the dangers of nuclear weapons were all about. When the war was over, when the bomb was dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, all I remember, all I wanted was the war to be over. And that's all I cared about. And it wasn't until later that I really, really understood or thought about the devastation that nuclear weapon created in Japan. And I even visited Hiroshima with my husband a number of years later just to sort of bear witness to that fact. But it was reading that book that made me aware. And then in the very, very early 60s, when so much attention was being paid to nuclear fallout and strontium 90 and what was happening to milk and what was happening to children who were drinking the milk. That, I think, is what propelled me into being so concerned there was some really sort of historic events that took place toward the end of the 50s. Actually, when I think back to the 50s, and during Eisenhower's, it was though we were living through a period of fallowness. Nothing, people were not as involved or concerned, and I think that was part of the whole Eisenhower administration, in what was truly going on in the world. And then we came into the Berlin Wall, and then the Cuban Missile Crisis, and I think the Cuban Missile Crisis, which really did bring us to the brink of nuclear war or nuclear exchange with Russia, was what precipitated so much of the public outcry that began to develop, and it began to develop with women who were concerned about their children and the concern about nuclear fallout. I think it was that kind of historic event. And at that point was when Louise and I came into the picture, actually. There was a group of women, I'm going to let Louise will talk about this, because it really happened at Louise Lam. It happened at her house. And a group of women got together, and Louise was really the catalyst, the precipitating factor in meeting some other women who were concerned. and suggested that we get together, that a group of women get together to see what we could do.
How did you know Louise?
Oh, right. Well, okay, so Louise and I have this very long history, which goes back to Lewiston, Maine. And it's a very unlikely connection, considering what Lewiston, Maine was all about. And I really shouldn't. Shouldn't pan it so much. It was a mill town like other mill towns, but it's very interesting that what came out of Lewiston, which was Louise and myself, and how we eventually both ended up in Newton. And Louise, who had a really long period of a really historic background in this kind of social action, much more so than I certainly had. But we all seem to be together in the same community at the same time with a group of other women who we gradually rounded up through our connections, through the PTA, mm-hmm. through the League of Women Vote, people that we knew, that it sort of went word of mouth. Somebody called somebody and said there's going to be a meeting, and there was all this. It was in the air. It was just in the air. It was a natural thing for women to come together around to see what could we do. And so eventually we became aware of a group in Canada who was just as concerned about these issues, and they were called Voice of Women. And as we had meetings in different people's houses, we knew how to organize. We knew how to organize because those of us who came together had been in the PTAs, we had been in the League of Women Voters, and I think those were the two primary groups that probably all had a common background, although there was, and we were social workers, some of us were social workers, so we had that kind of innate organizing ability. And some of us, not myself at the time, but some of us had belonged to the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, which was a very old organization, founded by Jane Addams, who was a social worker, or really a settlement house worker, who had gotten the Nobel Peace Prize because of what she had founded, which was the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, along with Emily Green Balch, who was an academic at Wellesley College, and they were suffragettes. So there's this long history that is going from one generation to the next. And we were that next generation that picked up on that in the preceding generation. And eventually, it wasn't just that we in Newton formed Voice of Women. There was a Cambridge group of women that have to be acknowledged, whose husbands, several of whose husbands, had been atomic scientists at Los Alamos in the development of the atomic bomb. And they, I think, really, if somebody will write that history up someday, were the really the beginning of the Voice of Women effort, peace effort. And several of those women became actually involved or aware of the Canadian group. And that part is a long history, actually. But gradually, somehow, although there were many women, there were women from Cambridge, women from the western suburbs, who joined, somehow the larger core group was Newton. And so eventually, over time, and we're talking now from 1961 on, that major group was Voice of Women in Newton. And when we did finally organize as a group, we almost immediately got thrown into a political campaign, because at that point Ted Kennedy was running for senator. There was an open seat, so Ted Kennedy was running and Henry Cabot Lodge was running. Two famous names were running. Henry Cabot Lodge's grandfather, I think, had been the person who kept us out of the League of Women Nations under Woodrow Wilson. And so he was running for senator. Ted Kennedy was running for senator. He didn't He was the president's brother, essentially, at that point. I think at that time, I don't think he didn't have that many credentials, I didn't think. I've certainly changed my mind since then. But initially, as a young man, he really, beyond his brother, the president, I think that was his major contribution, his major credential. And so an effort was made to run a peace candidate. And his name was H. Stuart Hughes, and he was a professor at Harvard. I think he was. Okay, H. Stuart Hughes was actually the grandson of Charles Evans Hughes, who was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, and during Wilson's time, and ran against Wilson for the presidency, and almost won. I think there's a famous headline that says, Hughes wins, but he didn't. But so that was interesting historically in and of itself. You had these three, you had Lodge, Kennedy, and Hughes. But Hughes was the peace candidate. And so we rallied around Hughes, and we did a tremendous amount of that. We all cut our teeth politically during this campaign. And it coalesced the group. Hughes lost. He lost he got a very small vote, probably because of the Cuban Missile Crisis. That sort of obliterated all news at that time, and his message of peace was not well received. But we were together. We were off and running. And so from that time on, I'd say most of us put in full time, almost, working first for nuclear testing, the ban on nuclear testing, which eventually President Kennedy did sign a treaty with the Soviet Union. And then the Vietnam War started, and then the Vietnam War took up our energies for the rest of the... Okay, I should elaborate on that. It was nuclear testing in the atmosphere, and the treaty that was signed between this country was to stop testing in the atmosphere, which was what we were all originally concerned about because of fallout. But it did allow nuclear testing, underground nuclear testing. But so that, I think we felt that we were part of a movement that had accomplished that. But then the Vietnam War started. And then from that period on until the Vietnam War stopped in the mid-70s, really, that was the primary focus of Voice of Women, was against the war and joining all movements, all efforts, coalescing with all groups that were involved in this. And there was so much that was going on in Newton and in the country at that time, and Voice of Women was part of it. We marched to Washington. I doubt if there was any major movement that took place that we were not involved with. Now, we have had an opportunity to write this up, and because of Newton 2000, Louise Lau, Kay Stein, and myself did write up the history of Voice of Women, which was published in the 20th century Newton, and there will be actually another publication that is more detailed about what we did, and as we were involved in the anti-Vietnam movement, of course the civil rights movement became part of the whole ferment of that time. And so those of us who were involved in the peace movement were also involved in the civil rights movement. And it's sort of exhausting when I think about it now, actually, but we were a lot younger at that point. And my involvement continued until 1969 primarily, because I went back to work. And I went back to work in the Newton Public Schools as a social worker. And I worked there for 21 years. And I retired almost 11 years ago. And so I often say that I worked in the Newton Public Schools for 36 years, but 15 of them were not paid. I did say that the history, we did write up the history, and there will be a more detailed history that Louise and I and Kay are putting together now under the auspices of Newton 2000. And that will be available. So if anybody who sees this film wants to find out more information, that will all be deposited at the Schlesinger Archives, actually. But there's one incident which wasn't written up. And it really combines the effort that we had both as a peace group and our involvement in civil rights. Because one of our concerns in the women's peace group in Newton, we were a group of white, middle class, probably upper middle class women. We did not have women of color that were part, except for Kathy Jones, who was a member of Voice of Women, and who also has a tape in this collection. And we really wanted to reach out to women in Roxbury, particularly because who had the same concerns that we had. And through connections, there was a group of women in Roxbury, and they were doing draft counseling, because their sons particularly were so vulnerable to the draft and to going to Vietnam. And so we did have these connections, and they were very important to us, and we did have meetings together. But when Martin Luther King was killed, there were uprisings, of course, all over the country. In the black communities, and there was in Roxbury, and at that point, when this terribly unsettled period was happening in Roxbury and in the Boston area, we had planned a meeting with Dagmar Wilson of Women's Strike for Peace, and I didn't even mention Women's Strike for Peace in this, but we certainly wrote about Women's Strike for Peace. That was the large national peace group. It also had other names. There was Women for Peace, Women's Strike for Peace, and different parts of the country had other names, but Women's Strike for Peace was probably the best known, and there is a good history that we will make a tape of or something, right? And at that particular moment, we had invited the founder of Women's Strike for Peace to come and talk with us, and we had planned the meeting in Roxbury. And we were advised not to go. And it was a terrible dilemma. How could we not have that meeting, and how would the women there feel about these white women from Newton not be willing to come into their community at that point? And so I don't remember how it happened, but somebody told me to call somebody, and I called the somebody and told us what our dilemma was, and that person said they would arrange to have a group of men would be available and they gave us a route to take, and the route was to go from Newton through Franklin Park to Roxbury, and there would be men lining the area, but we wouldn't see them, but they would be there, and they would make sure that we got to where we were going, and they would be there would be somebody outside of the house, and then when we had our meeting and we were ready to go, we should call. We were given a number to call, and then the process would be reversed, and they would be there to make sure that nothing happened to us, and until we got out of Franklin Park, probably. And so we did, and we went in sort of a convoy. I think we had three or four cars, and our husbands were not terribly excited about the idea, but we did. We insisted that we had to go, and we did it. And that was kind of, and we had a normal meeting. It was a very inspirational, actually, meeting with the women and hearing about what they were doing and sharing this event. But from that time on, the interconnection between the Newton and the black community started to really, this was a time of black power, and the connections really dissolved, and that to me was always a great regret. But I did want to get that in. So anyhow, we're in the 60s, working very hard, and as I said, I went back to work, and gradually over a period of time, although I stayed involved, I was less involved. And Voice of Women gradually dissolved too. I think, as a lot of people have mentioned, most of the people have mentioned in the tapes, that the Peace Boutique was developed. It became a center of all kinds of activities in Newton. There was so much going on in Newton that when you think about it and try to recapitulate what happened, it is sort of phenomenal. That's all I can say. And I hope that someday some historian will come along and write a complete history. I will say that we do have history instructor Suzanne McCormick from Boston College, who is getting her PhD thesis, who is writing her PhD thesis. Okay, I started to say that we have a history instructor at Boston College, a young woman, Suzanne McCormick, who was writing a thesis called Good Politics is Doing Something, Independent Diplomats and Anti-War Activists in the Vietnam Era Peace Movement, a Collective Biography. And when Ann started to do this, she went to the, and actually she told me,
Suzanne.
I asked her how she got involved in it, and she told me that her father was in the Vietnam War. He was an officer, and that he had been very pleased that there was a peace movement back home trying to do something. And she had sort of grown up with that, and when she became a budding historian, she decided to do her thesis, and she went to the Schlesinger Library to see if what she could find out about women during that period. She came there about the time that we brought our papers, or we had brought our papers about 6 months before then, and that was in 1992. And they told her that the papers had not been cataloged or organized, and so when she came back a few months later, they were. And so she has used those papers. And that's the significance of collecting history. And it's what, that's why the tapes that we're doing of the women that were involved in this core group of Voice of Women are important. And I think for the future, young women historians who will come along and as we would have done perhaps of the suffrage movement, they'll look to what women were doing in the 50s and the 60s, particularly the 60s and 70s. And that information will be there, and I consider this an important contribution that we're making. Just in thinking about it and thinking of the progression, I was so influenced by my mother particularly, who was so involved and concerned about social justice. As I said, I'd been brought up on the Sacco-Vanzetti case. And so she never let me forget what it meant to be a person and to do, that it was so important that you had to do something and that you had to be concerned about people who were poor, working conditions, to the point where I have never been able to cross a picket line. In my whole life, I have never crossed a picket line. I even canceled a workshop that I was supposed to give once in Connecticut because there was a picket line around. It had nothing to do with the workshop, but the hotel employees were picketing, and you had to cross a picket line, and I canceled it. I just didn't go. So that was so thoroughly ingrained in me. Now, with my children, I think I know I've had some influence. My oldest son is a community organizer. My youngest son is a photojournalist who uses his photography in terms of social issues. Our middle son died 22 years ago, actually, and he was also very concerned about social issues. I have a granddaughter who's graduating college this May, and she's always been involved or interested, and I designated her my holder of my papers at this point, whether she likes it or not. Our other grandchild, who is a boy, he's 14, he's very interested in sports at this point. He's an awfully nice person. So, but he doesn't also, he's not been able to escape my involvement. As a matter of fact, I just showed him the videotape. I showed him one of the videotapes that had been done already. And I showed him a videotape of the reunion just to get a reaction from him. His main reaction was, "Grandmother, I didn't realize you were such a comedian." So, true with that. So our kids have certainly, and from my husband too, because of his, as a physician, always interested in the lives of patients and the importance of being a good doctor. And that's what they were brought up, what it meant to the, for that kind of concern. So I think I think I see the next generation coming along. They'll do their thing in their own way. But that progression from one generation to another is there. As I look on today, which is, I said, was January, no, what is it?
January 30th,
right, 2002. What are we? How many days, how many months are we since September 11th? It seems like a lifetime. And I think of the situation we're in now. I feel as though we're going to have to get involved again in the kind of direction that our country is going, the kind of direction that our president and his cohorts seem to be taking us in terms of foreign policy, of war. We're on a war footing. We're losing the civil rights that are going to be lost based on the recommendations that this administration is recommending is enough to make you wonder just what the future is going to hold for us. And it's, and if things are going along the way they are now, it's not very good, hardly. So here we are again. Seems to me there's no rest for the weary. And I know there's an effort in Newton to organize and around peace issues. And I suspect this is going on in many other places around. I'm sure it is. It may not be in the newspapers because the news is being obliterated by what's happening in Afghanistan. But I'm sure, and that will be coming out. One difference that exists now is that we have this new technology. We have email, something we never had before. And therefore, we can communicate. We can forward. We don't have to use mimeograph machines anymore to crank out our newsletters. We have all this available technology, which means it's so much easier to get in touch with people and do something. And that's what, although I'm glad there's an, I hope there's another generation out there, but I will be there supporting them, and that's it. And in terms of technology, I have to give full credit to my husband, because if it was not for my husband, I would not have a computer or know how to use a computer. And it has been his ability that has enabled me to maintain this email connection with people. And I think it's extraordinary what we can accomplish. I have an email address book, and I forward things to them. And I think that's going to be an extremely important organizing tool for this current situation that we're in this country, is being able to communicate back and forth with such ease. It means we're not writing letters, and I feel sorry for future historians who are going to have to just have uninteresting email pages to look through. And but nevertheless, it exists. And so I give, as I say, I want to give full credit to my husband for keeping me technologically up to date.
And what kinds of things do you send people?
Well, I send things that people that Louise sends to me. She has a much better source of information, actually, than I have in terms of information that will come through. And if I, and I'm very selective. I don't just go through my address book, carte blanche. I select very carefully who I send what to. And I'm always sending messages to them. If I'm sending you too much, just let me know. And I've never gotten an asked.
What kinds of issues, though?
Well, on the issues, usually issues of relating to social work issues, social justice issues, certainly now around issues of the current situation in Afghanistan, civil rights issues. Those are really predominantly.
Conservation? Green
well,
decade?
Oh, that's right. I didn't remember. One of the other things I've been very involved in is the Green Decade Coalition, which is an environmental group in Newton. And I do give a lot of time to that, which was founded by Louise Bruin, who's also on one of these tapes, who also came out of the peace movement. So if you look at if you look at the people and who were in the peace movement during this period, and you look at them now, pretty much everybody is doing something of some significance, either in their community or involved with other groups of people. I try to take advantage of whatever technology we have in our house. Actually, we have a copying machine, we have a computer, we have a fax machine, and all of them have been used around the issues that I'm so concerned about. And in our answering machine, my message for years has been, and keep working for peace and social justice. And I think that's a good place to end. Well, I have certainly tried to use all technologies that are available now. We have a copying machine, the computer, a fax machine, and the answering machine. And I've taken advantage of the message by ending it up with, keep working for peace and social justice. It's more important now than ever before. And that message has been on that machine for several years now. Although people think I put it on since September 11th. So nothing's really changed.
Very good. I'll tell you, I have some friends whose kids get